Live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's a cloudy afternoon, everyone, here on Safari Live, and welcome. You are live on Safari Live. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Safari Live. My name's Byron, and on camera this afternoon is Brian with the thumb, and we have James and Dave on the other vehicle this afternoon, so you'll see them shortly. It's a beautiful day. It's been very cool and very cloudy. We haven't had any rain. We had a little bit this morning, but not too much today. It's about 22 degrees, about 78 degrees Fahrenheit, 22 degrees Celsius, which is very nice and cool, not as hot as what we're used to. So we are in search of predators this afternoon. We're going to try and look for some leopard. I actually just heard a bushbuck alarm calling not far from here, so I'd like to head down into that area and just have a look and see what we find. Maybe there's something walking around. We had a very exciting morning this morning. We had the lions on a buffalo kill. They had finished it from yesterday or from last night. And then they wandered through and they had another buffalo which they were feeding on, which was very, very interesting. We had the whole Unkahuma pride with a Birmingham male that was with them. And all the cubs were very playful. It was really, really a great morning. Don't forget, everyone, we are live from the Greater Kruger National Park in an area known as the Sabi Sands, and we are currently on Djuma Game Reserve. You can send us your questions through Twitter at hashtag Safari Live. Otherwise, email us questions at WildEarthTV and we'll gladly answer your questions or get your comments. It's always great hearing from our viewers. Trying to see now, having a good look around here to see where that bushbuck or Nyala sounded like a bushbuck. Maybe we're lucky and it saw a predator moving through here. There were lions around this area this morning, so I wonder if it was perhaps a lion that it saw or if it was something else. Let's have a look. There's some Nyala off to my right. Hang on a second, let me show you. Just through there, can you see them? Just in the thicket, a big male Nyala. Now, they seem to be feeding. There are actually quite a few of them. Wow, this is interesting. I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Looks like 5 Nyala bulls. There may even be more around here. So this is a bachelor herd. Now, I wonder if it was one of them that gave that alarm call. It could very well have been, but they seem very relaxed at the moment, browsing away in the thicket. Trying to listen out if I don't hear anything else, but it seems very quiet at the moment. No more alarm calls. Just going to roll forward a little bit. I might get you a better view of these Nyala. Let me know. How's that, Brian? There we go, it's a bit better. Look at these beautiful big males. You can see that one in the middle and then one off to the back left. But look at these horns. This is an impressive set of horns on this bull. See that white tip? It's a good sign of age. That's usually a good sign of age. It's probably an older bull, fully mature, and browsing very, very happily around here. Okay, so we're going to continue and see if we can't find any tracks of predators, lions or leopard, anything like that. While I do that, let's head over to James so he can say hello to you this afternoon.
Good afternoon, everybody. For those of you who didn't watch the pre-show, my name is James Hendry. On camera there's David. That's David's thumb. You saw it was very swiftly put into the line of the lens. Now, we've come into this area to try and find the Inkahuma pride. They were knocking about here sometime this morning, but they seem to have disappeared. Herbert is on foot trying to track them. Aubrey is around looking for them. There's a grey go-away bird going, quack, quack, over there, which sometimes they do if they've seen a predator, but I don't think they've seen a predator now. No, they still haven't found them. Anyway, I think they're in this drainage system here somewhere, so hopefully during the course of the afternoon we'll find them. Just to give you an idea, off to the left of where we are now, so the left of your screen, there's a road that runs up, and it runs almost parallel with the Mluamati drainage, which is the main sort of dry riverbed that runs through the middle of Djuma, which is where we are now. And then this road runs parallel for a little while, and then it turns away from the drainage line. So there's a fairly thick piece of block in front of us there that I think they're in. And so it could be a little bit difficult, but we're going to do our very best during the course of the next 3 hours or so to find them. And we'll see what else we can find as the afternoon progresses. It's a glorious cloudy day, 26 degrees Fahrenheit. That's 78 degrees. No, that's not 26 Fahrenheit. I wouldn't be dressed in shirt sleeves if it was. It is 26 degrees Celsius and 78 Fahrenheit, which makes for a very pleasant temperature indeed. And, of course, the cloud gave us a little bit of rain this morning. Not enough, but some. Good. Right. We are as live as Byron. Although, you know, the liveliness of Byron, I'm not sure what happened to his opening today. So do talk to us, hashtag Safari Live or questions at WildEarth.tv, and we would love to hear from you. Let's talk about anything you'd like to. Well, not anything you'd like to. Anything to do with the wilderness, Africa, South Africa, safaris, that sort of thing. I don't really wish to talk about soap operas. What else don't I want to talk about? Many things. Without further ado, let us go back to Byron so that he can make up for his beginning with a giraffe.
Is very old, judging by all that calcification around the skull. Can you see those thick knobs? There we go. Look at that. Isn't that interesting? And the older these giraffes get, the more prominent those knobs become. And you can see the horns or the ossicles, but even the ears. Look at that very, very old male. Ears are worn, completely bald on top. So this is a really old male, but he's got a beautiful color. He's actually quite dark. And if you have a look at that pattern, look at that, very, very dark. And the theory is that the older giraffe do tend to become darker, the older males. And you can see there, he's really, really old. And he's got this very reddish brown color, almost like an earthy red, soil that's rich in iron actually comes out that reddish color, and it's got very similar color to that, but the patches are very dark, very black. It's a beautiful coloration. It's just browsing happily on those leaves. There was another one that I saw off to the left, but I can't see it at the moment. It was a little bit deeper into the bush, so there's at least two males we can see. But we've spoken about it before, with a giraffe being so tall, they can keep an eye on each other from a distance, and they can spot one another. So occasionally you may see giraffe in a group, but they spread out over a fairly large area, but obviously with them being so tall, they can still spot one another. Look at that tongue, everyone. As they stick it out, very, very long tongue. Now, a big male like that, his tongue is probably around 40 to 45 centimeters long, which is incredible. And they'll use that tongue to strip the leaves off of the branches. Look at that. Wonderful. Jordan, good afternoon to you, and I understand you are a new viewer, so welcome on Safari Life. Jordan wants to know, why do the giraffe have horns? So Jordan, those horns, or what are also known as ossicles, it's actually part of the skull. That's bone that we can see there. And the horns are used, especially with the males, they are used for fighting. So the giraffe, when they fight, they do something known as necking, where they stand basically head to tail, so facing opposite directions, right next to one another, and they swing their necks around and they hit each other with those very hard horns, that bony structure on top of the head, and that can cause some serious damage. So with the males, it's mainly for fighting. Females also have them, and they may use them to protect themselves to an extent, but they don't use them as much as the males do. So the main reason would be for fighting. Oh, there's an oxpecker, everyone. Oh, look at that. That is a red-billed oxpecker. And it's picking off the ticks and the fleas that sit on the giraffe. Now, oxpeckers play a vital role in removing ticks off a lot of the animals in this environment. And the reason they do this is the oxpeckers actually, they enjoy the blood. That's what they're after. They feed on the blood. So those ticks are full of blood from sitting on the animals, and the oxpeckers will pick them off and feed on them. But what often happens too is you may get these oxpeckers sitting on animals that have got wounds, and they will pick at the wound to keep it open because they drink the blood. And that can often cause the wound to grow and get a bit larger, which is not ideal. So sometimes they can do a little bit of harm to the animals, but generally they do good and they pick off the ticks. Christy has asked, why do we call those horns on the giraffe's head ossicles and not ossicones? Christy, I do not know. I really don't know. That's just the name that's been given to them, ossicles. I don't know where the name comes from, to be honest. All I know is it is a bone structure, and it's interesting when they're born, those horns are actually flat against the head, and as they're born they then stand up, and as they grow and they get older, that calcification around the head hardens and those horns become a lot more solid, and they really get fixed to the top of the skull. As James mentioned, I struggled a little bit with the opening. I don't know what happened there. Brian and I had a good chuckle about that. I don't know. I don't know what happened there. But James has got some bovine that he'd like to show you. So let's head over to him.
That is the most hilarious thing I've heard all day long, everybody. What on earth is an ossicle? It sounds like some sort of frozen piece of bone sugary frozen bone that one might consume on a warm afternoon, such as the one we're experiencing now. Anyway, there are some buffalo. They do not have ossicles on them. They don't have icicles on them. They don't have popsicles on them. They've got horns, which are quite similar to ossicles in many ways. I mean, ossicones, of course. I've actually forgotten what the difference is, but I think the difference is that the ossicones of a giraffe, while they grow out of the skull, they are born with them, and buffalo are not born with their horns, and they're also born unfused to the skull. And in the first few days of life, they stand up on end, and the cartilage that joins them to the skull then hardens, it ossifies into the bone that then eventually becomes the giraffe's horn or ossicone. Here, I think they grow entirely from the base, from a bud in the skull. And that is the difference there, I think. And this is not a very attractive sort of hairdo she's got there, is it, David? She's you're really not painting her in a flattering light. I mean, she looks okay like that. Go back to that image you had there. That's just doesn't do her justice, I feel. That sort of scraggly hair on top, no hair on the face, which I suppose if you're a human being is a good thing, but if you're a buffalo, you want to have a good covering of hair. Yeah, and she's dribbling. No, I think we should move on from her. Buffalo do dribble, everybody, and they dribble for a very good reason. They dribble because they, of course, have to chew and chew and chew, and that chewing produces, or necessarily produces, a huge amount of saliva, which in turn necessitates their drinking often twice a day, especially in winter. Now, the lions we have obviously not come across, and if Taylor was sitting where I am now, I've no doubt a lion would leap from behind a bush and jump onto one of these buffalo, but I don't have quite that luck. And so what we're going to do, we think the lions are somewhere behind us there. Herbert is following up there. We'll drive in and around there. It would not surprise me to know that the lions had heard these chaps moving in here. It's a very small herd of buffalo, probably about 50 or so, but they will let out the odd belch and that sort of thing. We know that those Nkuhumas have been massively successful over the last little while catching buffalo, so it wouldn't surprise me if the reason that they've moved is that they heard these guys here and are perhaps stalking from the undergrowth as we speak. While we're looking at the buffalo, there's also a zebra, David. Whoops, the buffalo to the side of us got a little bit of a fright. And if I was that zebra, I wouldn't be hanging around with buffalo when the Nkuhuma pride are around. There are three or four of them, and they're all in this area because it seems to be it's a ridge crest, which might not look like a ridge crest, but it is, and that means, of course, that there's very well-drained soil, and the grass, when it's rained, will be particularly good, and so that's why they're all up here enjoying the flush of green that's come as a result of our summer rains. And I just love the days like this, you know, when there is a bit of cloud, the cuckoo's still calling, red-chested cuckoo, in the background, and as always, an air of expectancy of perhaps a little bit more rain. It's quite close, so it's quite humid. Do you use that term where you're from, everybody? The term close, I quite like it to describe a sort of humid atmosphere where it feels like the air is actually touching you. It's quite close today. Right, so let's move on from these beefies. We're going to turn around 180 degrees. Hello, Alice. You're in Ohio as opposed to Wonderland. I'm not sure why I made that joke. Alice, you're saying oxpeckers, and you've correctly pointed out that they drink blood. Are they the only birds that drink blood? Alice, not really. I mean, I think they're probably the only birds that specialize in it. You know, I mean, a vulture or an eagle or any bird like that will drink blood if they can get it, but they're not adapted to doing it. So, I mean, they will drink and eat the blood of their prey. But I think an oxpecker is probably the only one that takes blood from a tick. I'm just trying to think of any others that there might be. No, I think they probably are the only kind of specialist, what would we call it, hemivore. I suppose that would be something that drinks blood, a hemivore. But I mean, there are lots of others that would get blood in their, you know, in their meal. All the birds of prey would. Right, Herbie's checking down there along what we call the Gowrie cut line. We're going to go up here, which is Hyena Road. There's a giraffe there with some ossicles, and there's a zebra with some strippies, and a buffalo with some hones, and also on it, two oxpeckers which have flown away. She's not much better looking than the last one we saw, was she? There. Beautiful. Now, much younger, I think, than the giraffe you saw with Byron. And I think we saw the giraffe that you saw with Byron on Twin Dams. And you can see he's younger. His skin is in better condition. His ossicles aren't quite as robust. Let's move up a little bit here. Really is a lot of animal life on this ridge crest, which is marvellous. There's the zebra, which of course we say zebra in this country. Adam, you're wondering about a giraffe's tongue and whether it stops growing. I'm pretty sure it does. I'm pretty sure it stops growing when the giraffe stops growing. But that said, because of what it eats, because it must rub its tongue over thorns and, you know, it takes quite a lot of wear and tear. I suppose a little bit like teeth of the herbivores that keep growing all the time. You know, it's constantly replacing, I think, the epithelium or the outer layer of the tongue. And so from that point of view, it probably doesn't stop growing, but it doesn't, I don't think, it get any longer. I certainly haven't seen very old giraffes with noticeably longer tongues. There really is a lot going on here. There's some more buffalo up ahead. So those lions are probably not too far from this vicinity. Now the reason there are buffalo, of course, is that there are these pans all the way along here. So there's the good grazing on the ridge crest. And as you come off the ridge crest to the seep lines, which is what we're on now, there are these pans of water which the buffalo will drink from and lie in. Look at that lovely green algae there, David. Looks like a very pleasant pea soup. Do you like pea soup, David? Mmm. Doesn't smell like pea soup, does it? No. You might also be able to hear some whistling noises. And that's those nomadic wattled starlings. Hello, Finn. You're just 8 years old. How good to hear from you. Thank you for sending us a question, Finn. Finn, you want to know why it is that buffalo lose their hair? You know, probably for two reasons. The first is those oxpeckers, and you would have seen under that buffalo's eyes, she had no hair at all, and she had sort of hard white skin. That's because the oxpeckers pick the ticks off in that area. That's where ticks go, because ticks will go anywhere where there's moisture, and you know that even on your eyes, there's quite a lot of moisture around them. So a tick will go towards them on a buffalo, and then the oxpeckers will take the ticks off, and that will pull the hair out. And then they also rub their heads a lot on each other, and they rub them in bushes. They get itchy, and so they rub their heads against wood and through thorns, and so that takes the hair out as well. And that's why they get a little bit bald as they get older, but like a few others I know of. Let's carry on down the road here. So this is probably part of the same buffalo herd. And the same buffalo herd that is kind of split up. We'll just have a very close-up view of a buffalo cow. Oh no, well that's a bull. Oh, He looks to have had something of a stroke. It's very odd. Let me just look there. No, he doesn't have a, hadn't had a stroke. He's just got a swollen lip. Something's not quite right there, is it? I wonder if he hasn't broken his nose at some stage. That is fascinating. All right, Byron has done a little bit of research, everybody. So from this rather unsymmetrical or asymmetrical buffalo bull, we're going to head across to Byron's Sarah and find out the difference between an ossicle, a popsicle, an icicle, and an ossicone.
I do apologise, everyone. The horns on top of giraffe are ossicones. I don't know why I said ossicles. I really don't. Something's clearly happened to me this afternoon. Perhaps it's a cloudy weather, and I'm sorry. So there are ossicones on top of the giraffe's head, and I do believe that James is going to shout at me this evening. So I'm not looking forward to that. Perhaps I should just start again. So good afternoon, everyone. I'm Byron. We've got Brian on camera and the thumb, and we are on Safari Live, and we're looking for animals to show you. I will do better from now on. I promise I'll do better this afternoon. I'm actually just driving along the Gowrie cut line at the moment, and the reason I'm doing that is to see if we've got any predators that have possibly crossed over onto our side during the course of the day. And because it has been a lot cooler, chances of animals like leopard and lion moving around during the day are a lot higher. So that's what I'm hoping for. And also, you never know, we might find leopards hunt in weather like this. They do enjoy it. When it's cooler and a little bit windy, they're able to hide and stalk, and they are a lot more active than people actually realize. So you never know, it could happen. I'm hoping, here we go, there's some Impala off to our right, and an Nyala. It's always wonderful seeing all these antelope around. There's two Nyala, and then a herd of Impala around here. So both these species would be ideal prey for leopards. I have not yet seen a big male leopard since on this stint that I've been with Safari Life, and I've been here now, what's it, 12 days or so. I mean, we found Karula the other morning with her two cubs, which was wonderful, and Tingana has been close to us, but just on the other side of the boundary, on our eastern boundary. I know Taylor got to see him the other day once or twice, which was really lucky, but I have not yet seen a big male leopard since I have been here, so that would be wonderful to find. This cut line that we are now is called Cheetah cut line, and it's usually quite productive for animals. And Kat from Tampa would like to see some hyena, and Kat, so would I, but for some reason, and I heard from the other guides too, that they have not seen hyena for ages. But it's interesting. I've seen hyena tracks a lot, or driving around, but just no sign of the hyena. So they're probably more active at night, moving around, and then most likely moving off of Djuma. And my thinking is that it's possibly because of the high predator density at the moment, or basically because of all the lions. There's a lot of lion activity around, and these Birmingham males are around. Hyena don't like that, and even though The hyena generally scavenge off lions at times. I think with the size of the pride and because of the cubs, the females are probably a bit more aggressive, and with the males around, the hyena would have no chance. And if they got caught by these lions, the lions would kill them. So I think that's possibly why we haven't seen many hyena. But it would be wonderful. You never know. Cats, we tend to bump into things on a regular basis, so we could bump into a hyena on drive this afternoon or this evening. See something ahead crossing the road. Not sure if it's buffalo. It's quite far up ahead. Let's go have a look. While I go investigate if these are buffalo, James is sitting with buffalo at the moment. So head over to him.
Well, that doesn't look like a buffalo to me. Does it look like a buffalo to you, David? No. I don't know. Byron is really falling apart today. He's really lost his mind. Anyway, that is not a buffalo. It is a waterbuck. And on its bottom, of course, the distinctive white ring. Good. Now, that is, as I've told you before, the only, at least the one of them, there's a subspecies of waterbuck that lives up in the Mara called the Defasa waterbuck that doesn't have that, of course. And we saw that up there, which was very nice. Now, there are two bulls here, and they're feeding on what we call the ecotone. Now, the best way for me to describe the ecotone for you would be to, Dave, if you can, you see the big marula tree on the ridge crest?
Yep.
Right, so that is the ridge crest, everybody. That big tree through, around the side there is a marula tree. That is indicative of the ridge crest. And then as you come towards us, there we go, we get Cambritum, the green trees, and then we're into this position here. If we pan around to where those beefaloes are, there, they are standing on the seep line. Now, in between the seep line and the ridge crest is what we call an ecotone, and it's an area where two vegetation types meet, and that is where waterbuck like to live. Often found on the ecotones, and I think it's quite possibly one of the reasons that we see waterbuck so much here, and very seldom around water. I think that there are quite a few sort of gentle undulations in the topography here, which means that there are lots of different ecotones. And that means that it has its ideal habitat for waterbuck, bar the water, of course. Because there are, to my mind, an unusual number of waterbuck here, especially given the lack of very large water bodies. And indeed, during the drought, their numbers seemed to increase here rather than decrease. Right, let's move on from here. Another very small herd of buffalo of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. See if you can count them as we drive slowly past everybody. I mean, there are probably 10 or 11 animals there. That's a tiny little herd. Probably all part of a much larger herd, but lurking about like they are in such a small herd is just inviting attack. Now, I was chatting to Steph today. Whoops. I was chatting to Steph today, and he was saying how the buffalo are, well, I mean, we told you about Taylor's experience where that buffalo chased her into the tent the other day. Steph's had a couple of experiences on foot where he hasn't been chased, but the buffalo are just seemingly on edge. Well, I mean, it's obvious why they're on edge. They're being smashed by the lions. And they're being smashed by the lions because they're weak. They're weak, they've split out of their big herds because of the drought. They're into these little groups. They're weakened by the lack of food. And I just think that they're being extremely easy to pick off. In fact, the two lionesses and those eight cubs and one fairly useless male managed to take down a little calf yesterday, I think is fascinating. Where was the rest of the herd? Normally, a big herd like that would protect a little calf, especially in the middle of the day. Buffalo don't normally get panicked in the middle of the day. So it's all rather interesting. Just still listening to the radio to see if anyone's found tracks of
the, thank you very much.
Found tracks of the lions. That was very loud, David. Sorry about that. And we will obviously sort out these radios so that they are silent once more. Ooh. Just onto that hornbill there. It's got a little thing in its mouth, a tiny little insect, which it's now devoured. I thought it might be taking it to its wife, who I'm sure was holed up in a tree hole. Look at his eyelashes. Now, that's looking for... This is one of the trees, actually, that produced a huge number of invertebrates last year around about this time. It's a peltiforum tree, or a weeping wattle, and I think he's just scouring the branches for signs of insects, perhaps cicadas. I can hear a whole group of cicadas, or cicada, if you're living in North America. I can hear them up north of us where we are, from where we are now, making their lovely summer sound. And I'm sure that's the kind of thing that he's looking for. And those eyes are sharp. They're much sharper than ours. They'll be able to pick out details the likes of which you and I would never be able to see. And just again, the dexterity and agility of that bird to be able to move around, hop from branch to branch, I think is always amazing. Can you imagine sitting in a tree and jumping from branch to branch? And remember, they can't open their wings there. Righty, very nice, David. Let us continue. That is the southern yellow-billed hornbill, if you're wondering. And I do think that Byron should try and do an impression of the southern yellow-billed hornbill. I'd pay quite a lot of money to see that. How to throw your mate under the bus, 101. He says he's shaking his head. I don't think he's going to do it. You'll have to ask him, everyone. Right, no tracks of the lions as far as I can see. Let's go up this way and see if they haven't popped out onto the Biffles or cut line. That's the Biffles or cut line, which is our northern boundary. And obviously, if you are a new viewer, it's not a boundary that we're not, that the animals aren't allowed to cross. We can't go north or south of our traversing area, but the animals are free to come and go as they please. Look at the kudu there. She's using that termite mound as a vantage point. Isn't that cool? See that, everyone? Hello, Jenna. You're in Cape Town. It's really nice to hear from South Africa, although Cape Town's sometimes considered not part of South Africa, but that's by Cape Townians. Jenna, you're wondering if I've ever been sitting with a herbivore and then been shocked by a predator leaping out. I think probably once or twice. I can't think of an exact incident, but my memory tells me that I have seen that. I've certainly been watching them and then seen predators stalking them. And we had an incident the other day with Karula, and we were watching some, I think it was Impala and Nyala, drinking at the Djuma pan. And I was kind of scanning the bush either side, and way across the dam I spied the spots through a little gap in the bush. And there she was, just looking out over the dam, trying to see if she couldn't perhaps find something small enough for it to get. I actually think we were watching buffalo drinking, so they were too big for her to go for. And she waited very patiently there till they'd moved off, and then she slunk out, and nobody saw her. It was wonderful to see. But yes, they could be anywhere around here, and certainly these Nkuhumas who have been hunting in the day, they've been hunting hugely during the day, they could be anywhere around here. I suspect that's why that kudu's sitting on the top of that mound, standing guard. Okay. Great news, everyone. Byron has found another ossicle-topped animal.
James, stop it. So in the spirit of starting again, I found giraffes with ossicle cones on their head. And there's a beautiful example there of this. Looks like a male, that one at the back. But look how dark he is compared to that female. This is a female just off to the right. And now you can see color variation. Look at that. Isn't that incredible? How dark that male is compared to that female. Look at that. As I was saying, the genetically, some giraffe are just darker than others, but the theory is also that the older the giraffe get, they tend to get a lot darker, and especially the males. The older males do turn a bit darker, their coloration. Look at him hiding in the trees there. So what we're going to do is we're going to head towards Biffle's Hook Dam to see if we've got any movement of animals around there. I'd love to find some elephant this afternoon. That would also be wonderful. And I got an update from some of the other guides in the area. And it sounds like Tingana, that big male leopard, is on the property to our east on Torchwood. And unfortunately, we can't go there, but he has been around there for the last few days. He's had a kill. I think he killed a large impala. So that leopard will stay in that area until he's finished it. And then it sounds like Karula and her two cubs crossed south. I think Taylor saw their tracks this morning crossing south over our boundary, which is sad, but very fortunate that we did get to see them. It was exciting for me because I hadn't seen them for quite some time. So it was nice to see the cubs and see how big they are. Billy wants to know, do these giraffes have any feeling in their mouths? Billy, they do, but their lips and their tongues are very, very thick, almost rubber-like, their tongue. The thorns do not affect them. You can see they're feeding on those acacia trees with those very, very sharp thorns. And their thick lips and tongue protect them against the thorns, and they're able to feed on all those leaves. And the reason they like the acacia trees is because the nutrients in the acacia leaves are very, very high, and there's a lot of good food there for them, and the leaves taste very good. That is why they have the thorns, and that's to try and protect them. But as you can see, it doesn't really affect the giraffe at all. And wrapping its tongue right around those branches and stripping the leaves off really is incredible if you see how sharp those thorns are. Sun's peeking through some of the clouds as it's starting to drop, but it's still very, very cloudy. But look at that. See the sun just peeking through there. It's warming things up a little bit. It was much cooler earlier, but aren't those clouds beautiful? Lovely, lovely scene at the moment around us. We're going to continue towards Biffle's Hook Dam and see what we can find around there. Anyway, it was nice to see the giraffe and their ossicones. Actually, we are hoping to have a rainy year ahead. It's been an incredibly dry year in southern Africa. The rainfall has been a lot less than it usually is, and that's why we've had such a bad drought. So we are hoping that we get some more rainfall, or a lot of rainfall for the next summer season. That's when we get our rainfall. So from now up until about February, March, hopefully we get a lot of rain. And here's another interesting antelope to show you. Have a look at this, everyone. Off to our right, we've got a wildebeest. And he seems to be by himself, which is not unusual. And I'll tell you why, that this is probably a territorial male. So what he has done is set up a territory in this area, and he'll most likely have a little rubbing patch where he rubs in the sand, and a rubbing post that he'll go and rub the sand off of himself and get rid of ticks and that against a tree somewhere. But they do like to roll around in an area where that is very sandy, and it's to protect their skin and get rid of ticks and fleas. And then that will basically mark his territory, and what he'll do is he will defend this against other males until a group of females walk past, and he will then try and get them to stay in his territory so that he may mate with them. And often you'll find these dominant male wildebeest hanging around with impala and occasionally zebra, and the reason for that is just for safety, so that there are a few more eyes around keeping a lookout for any predators or any danger. But he looks like he's by himself at the moment. And speaking of zebra, James has got, perhaps he is the lone wildebeest with those zebra.
Well, there are some zebra again, everybody.
They've got animals running around all over the place. Sounds like kudu and impala.
I'm just listening to the radio, everyone.
Possibly by wild dogs on the little Gowrie driveway area. So I don't know if you guys want to check along Gowrie Main.
Copy, Lex. Yeah, I think we'll definitely one of us will head down there. I'll head down there now. Thanks very much. Did you hear about that, everybody? It sounds like there could well be wild dogs on the southern boundary. I think that for now, while we've got Herbie looking for the lions here, I think we should head down there, because I think Byron's going to Beefelshoek Dam to see what's there. If, of course, we do come across the dogs, we'll pull Byron into the sighting to help us. Whoops. So let's head down there quite quickly. And you heard, of course, that the dogs haven't been found, but there are lots and lots of animals running around and alarm calling and basically panicking all over the place. So we're hopefully going to find some wild dogs. In the meantime, we'll take a look at the sort of sky as we drive along. There we are. Give you some sort of entertainment, other than just listening to me. There we are. God. And just over my head there is a, I think probably Mrs. Wahlberg. And I'm just going to keep an eye, that was a pathetic piece of presenting. You couldn't actually see the bird, so that was bad of my part. I just was distracted quickly by the thought of looking at the ground, because this is where we thought the lions might have come. But it doesn't look like they have. So we're going to drive quite quickly now. Take out your dentures. Strap yourselves in. If you are having a drink, well, I'd suggest you finish half of it while we go. Lean into the corners. There is a great bevy of vultures flying off. They were obviously here feeding on the remains of the lion kill that was around here. This is where they killed their buffalo yesterday. That is gorgeous light. That really is quite spectacular. Isn't that lovely? White-backed vultures. Very nice, David. That's enough. Let's carry on. Just on the off chance that we can see some doggies. Mahlolwa. The term that the guides use around here for wild dog is a madash, which again is one of those strange words that's come into parlance that has no noticeable origin. The Shangaan word for wild dog is masholwa. Pop across the dam wall. We'll have a quick look at more vultures. That's very ominous, isn't it, David? Don't they look ominous on the dead tree? Oh, if I'd seen them yesterday on Halloween, we'd been sore terrified. Right, that's enough of that. Carry on. Try and start the car. There we go. There's a hippo. I haven't seen the hippo in this particular piece of water for some time. Anyway, hello. Is the dam cam? Is the dam cam working? Okay. You have seen them there before, apparently. I haven't seen them for some time. Oh, beautiful smell. You know what it is? Just quickly, Dave. Sorry. All the way from there, it's probably about 50 meters away, there's a tree with yellow flowers on it. It's a gardenia tree. And the smell is delicious. It's sweet, fragrant, sort of a little bit like a rose mixed with a jasmine, I suppose. Very nice. Then there's, of course, the air touched with the smell of rotting flesh, which, given the number of buffalo that the lions have killed around here, is not surprising. Right. I think those are the Nyala over there that Byron showed you at the very beginning of the show, so we won't stop for them. I'm just going to get an update quickly from Abel. Okay, no. There's no update. Impala running all over the place. We're nowhere near the southern boundary just yet, so they're not running around because they're worried about the wild doggies. All right. So please do excuse the speed if you've just joined us. We are trying desperately to get to the southern boundary because we've heard possible reports of wild dogs heading this way. Wild dogs, of course, my favorite animal out here. And I know many of you will be very excited to see some wild dogs. David, will you be excited to see wild dogs? Yes, I thought you might. Yes. Can't drive too fast in Jigger because we'll throw David off the back. And because he's so quiet, we won't notice him go. We'll suddenly arrive at the sighting and I'll turn round and he won't be there anymore and I'll have to film. And then it'll be blurry safaris. Hold on, David.
Fine, we're here on Central Road.
I once was driving with David. I'm sure many of you were probably on the sighting, and I can see him laughing now because he's remembering. And I have told you the story, but we were chasing the lions across quarantine clearings. They were chasing some wildebeest, and I thought I was doing the most spectacular presenting job in the world. I was driving after them, I'd positioned them perfectly next to the vehicle, and then we had to cross one of the roads and we hit the bump, and it was a little bit of a bump, but I didn't turn around, I just carried on. The lion was running next to us, and then I looked down at my monitor and I saw the sky, which is of course what you were seeing. And that David, I turned around, he was lying on the back of the car with his legs in the air like this because I'd lost him. I'd bounced him clean out of his seat and he was lying with his legs in the air, and of course all you were seeing were the clouds leaping about. Yes, we got some, yes, good airtime. And of course what we discovered from that is that chasing animals while they're on the run and trying to film them is often more a seasickness event than it is an actually entertaining event. Right, we'll go right down to the southern boundary and then turn to the west. Word on the wire is that Karula has killed something else, fortunately, again to the south. So we won't be seeing her today. We did get to spend a full 3 hours with her yesterday afternoon, which was just tremendous. And I was struck again by, well, struck for the first time by how much bigger little Hosanna the male is. Excuse me. How much bigger the male is than the female. And they are now, if I'm not mistaken, 9 months old tomorrow. So the great queen has done very well to get to this point with all of them. Get out of the way, Impala. I'm sorry, I do appreciate you, but we want to go and see if there's some... There's a giraffe, female, small ossicles on the female. There is so much animal life around here at the moment, it's wonderful. There's another female giraffe with some ossicles. Sorry, David, I am giving you a bit of a hack. Hello, Donovan. That's very nice to know that when you are big, I will still have an opportunity to be employed, which is, of course, always a worry for a safari guide. You say that you will, when you grow up, you want to own a safari lodge and you want Byron and I to come and work for you. Well, Donovan, it would be an honor to come and work for you. I hope that you will be a good boss and kind to us and pay us many bonuses. If that is the case, we will certainly come and work for you. Thank you, Donovan, for your offer of employment. I may have to take you up on it. Can David come too, Donovan? David also might be unemployed by then. And can you also buy your safari lodge quite soon, Donovan, because I'm not getting any younger. And you know, at 40 years old, let's say that you buy your safari lodge when you're 20, that's in 12 years' time, I'll be 52. That's really old, isn't it? Well, for you it is. For me it won't be. There's a very large bird. Let's move out. Sorry, David. It is a martial eagle, David. It is. There it goes. And as it flies off, you may have just heard the squirrels going tick 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 tick. In fact, it wasn't squirrels, it was dwarf mongoose. Wingspan of some 21, at least 210 centimetres, 2.1 metres. That's about 7 feet. Beautiful. Okay, we're really very close to the southern boundary now. Oh gosh, this piece of road is really falling apart slightly. There we are. These Impala look chilled to the max, as they say. They don't seem to be too panicked. So what we'll do is we'll go under the boundary and then just switch off and have a listen. Right, here we are. Hold on, David. We're going to swing to the right.
Okay, got you.
Keep an eye out for some tracks and also for some alarm calls. I just want to go a little bit along here so we know how fast those dogs move. They could be into Biffle's Hook by now. Just listening to the radio, sorry.
Yes,
And no, we're okay, I think. It should have been around here somewhere. Just go a little bit further and then switch off and listen. Okay. Around here. See if we can hear any sounds of panicked antelope, charging kudu. No, just the sound of the ghost bird. And the black-headed oriole, and the very pleasant breeze coming from the east. No, nothing so far. Okay, let's go a little bit further. Right, in the meantime, let's head across to Byron, find out if he's managed to reach Biffle's Hook, and if he found his elephants there.
Not quite at Biffle's Hook just yet, James. We're almost there, and we're going to see what that has in store for us. I'm guessing we're going to see a hippo. Brian, what do you think?
Yeah, hippo.
Let's see. It is a bit cooler today, so that hippo could possibly be lying out of the water somewhere. You never know. Still no sign of any elephant, and I would like to see some elephant this afternoon. Always really enjoy spending time with them. We had a really exciting morning for birding, and well, I was very excited because we got to see bronze-winged courser, which is a nocturnal bird and usually quite difficult to see, and they were walking through the thicket or through the scrub, and then we saw a kingfisher called the grey-headed kingfisher, and that was very quick. Unfortunately, we weren't able to show it to you, but it's only the second time I've ever seen one, so it was really exciting for me and not that common in this area, so it was very, very nice. All right, James has got a bird that he would like to show you quickly.
It's gone, everyone. We're going to try and find it again, and I bet it's not on many of your bird lists. It's a European golden oriole. We see them quite often, but we don't get them on camera, and we had this thing perfectly framed for about 3 seconds, and then it disappeared. I'm just going to go backwards a little bit, see if it doesn't fly. It's the first time I've actually managed to get the cameraman into a position where he can see it. They like to be in the thick marula branches. They're very secretive. If they don't fly, it's almost impossible to see them. Let's just keep an eye there, and I'll take out the book and show you a picture of what it looks like. No, I think it's gone. You know what? Let's cheat. I'm going to play its call. Hello, Alice in Wonderland / Ohio. You were hoping to see a black-headed oriole today. Well, this thing, to my mind, is even more beautiful. And what I'm going to do is play its call and see if we can't convince it to come out. Isn't that gorgeous? Well, this one, wherever it is, doesn't seem particularly concerned about this lot. Byron says I probably saw a weaver. Well, that is very That is very rich, coming from somebody who's been seeing a sort of form of a sweet pudding on giraffes' heads for most of his life. No, they're so secretive. Anyway, there it is. There's the Eurasian golden oriole. You can see it's distinctive from the black-headed in that it doesn't have a... Well done, David. No black head. And that is the African one down there. And this one, Byron will tell you, when he was on training, we had the most amazing time with an African golden oriole. We sat with it in a tree probably for about 25 minutes. It was in plain, gorgeous, beautiful view. And that, to my mind, is the most beautiful oriole that we get. But the Eurasian ain't too far from it. And what you look out for, if you see them flying, is the very, very black wings and this flash of yellows that opens the wings off its back. Anyway, hopefully sometime during the summer, we'll be able to show you a Eurasian golden oriole. There are no wild dogs around here. Anyway, maybe the universe has brought us into this area for another reason. Those buffalo are looking to the south. Hello, Rob in New Jersey. You want to know if the Baltimore Oriole has ever been spotted here? I'm assuming you're being slightly tongue-in-cheek. No, not as far as I know. I don't think the Baltimore Oriole has ever been seen in the Kruger Park. Well, this is where they thought the dogs were, right here. Now, this very small breeding herd of buffalo, considering consisting of one bull and one cow, is looking suspiciously down towards the south. Let's ask them if they've seen any wild dogs. That is, of course, a very unchivalrous buffalo. You can see he's hiding behind his wife, which is very, very poor form indeed. Have you seen any wild dogs? Have you? Not. Well, she's talking to us, he's not. Come on, dear, he says, let's get out of here. They do look like a rather grumpy old couple, I must say. Well, thanks for your help. Thank you. Off you go. If you don't get eaten by the Nkuhuma pride. Right, let's carry on here. Keep looking behind us just to check. All right, let's continue with Byron's story. I don't know what fanciful things he was telling you before we saw the weaver. Let's head back and find out.
I was just talking about the birds that we saw this morning, James. Unfortunately, it sounds like you just missed that oriole, which is a pity. They are beautiful birds, and you don't see them often. I think I've only seen that one in this area once or twice. Speaking of birds, there's one flying over there. Will it land? It looked like a purple roller. Let me just see. It did land in the tree over there. Hang on a second. Can you get it through there, Brian? Let's see. Looks like a purple roller, perhaps. And it is indeed. Yes. There we go. James, I identified something correctly first time. So I think I'm back. And these rollers are also very, very beautiful. Not as colorful and vibrant as the lilac-breasted roller. Oh, beautiful birds, the rollers. And we watched one this morning catch a dung beetle in flight. Swooped down, caught the dung beetle and ate it. So it was really interesting to see. Also just shows you how strong those beaks are of these rollers, because the dung beetles, I mean, they've got some serious... That was a serious exoskeleton, a very hard exoskeleton. And that purple roller managed to feed on it very easily. Nice to see that roller. Trying to listen out if I can't hear any elephant. Perhaps they're moving around somewhere. I can hear an emerald spotted wood dove in the distance. Trying to hear if it calls again. Something like that. Let us continue. Nice to see that purple roller. Nice open section that we are driving along now, so we might have animals passing through. Sorry, some flies around here at the moment. The edge of a drainage line, which is just off to our left. And I always say it, but these thickets and drainage lines are great areas for leopards to move through, because they don't like to be seen very much. They're very secretive cats. So Lara, the rarest animal that I've ever seen in this reserve is a pangolin, and it was just south of here. And a pangolin is a nocturnal animal. I'll show you a picture of one shortly. Let me just move out the way of this other vehicle quickly, and I'll show you a picture of a pangolin. They are wonderful animals, but very, very rare. Let me quickly get my book out and I'll show you a picture of a pangolin. Afternoon, everyone. How are you? How's it going? Let me see where this pangolin is. And Laura, not many of them have been seen in this area. And I know there was one seen on Safari Live not too long ago. Brian, it was a few months ago, was it not? Yeah. And that is a pangolin, also known, some people refer to them as scaly anteaters. I just heard something snort. So Laura, this was probably the rarest animal that I've seen in this area. And I know a lot of guides and people that have been working in the bush for many years, and they've never seen one of these. And I was fortunate enough to see one while I worked in this area, in the Sabi Sands. And recently I've been guiding people all over, and we've been going to the Kalahari quite a bit. And I think now I must be on about 14 pangolin in the last year and a half, which is amazing. I've seen a lot of pangolin there. They tend to be a bit more active, and it's easier to find them. The sand makes it easier to track. So I've seen quite a few over there. We're going to continue our search for elephants. James has got some pigs he'd like to show you.
Pork. Everybody, pork. Delicious. Warthog, quite possibly the most delicious thing you can eat out here. Although that does sort of put one off a little, doesn't it, David? Yes. Anyway, they've done really well, I think, during the drought. I've said this to you before. They've survived very well, and now they'll begin to put on very nice condition with all of this green grass that they're eating. And they're sticking to what essentially is a fire break. That's a sort of clearing here on the sides of the road. And that's so that they can see what might want to come and eat them. In this case, it could be something like, Karula if she was coming back. Otherwise, those wild dogs would go for warthog. Now, David, just behind us, It's starting to cool. It's the red-crested Kohan, everybody, and they are doing their suicide display at the moment. I think there are too many trees there for us to see that. That's the bird that jumps up into the sky and then crashes to the ground again, just opening his wings on time. All right, let's carry on from here and see if we can't find anything at Treehouse Dam. This, of course, everybody, is our first, I suppose you'd call it summer drive. So we'll be going until 7 o'clock this evening. They'll give us about half an hour of darkness at the end of the drive, which, when it's hot, is a very good thing. Now, I don't know if we've managed to catch the suicide bird on camera doing its display. I've never seen it with you on camera, but I'm sure maybe somebody has managed to catch it. But if we can, it really is, it's a very amusing thing to see. Tingana is still on Torchwood. We still don't have the lions, obviously, otherwise we'd be with them. But there is an astounding amount, I think, of general game. What have we seen? We've seen Duiker, you've seen Nyala, Wildebeest, Zebra, Buffalo, Impala, Waterbuck, many, many, lots of different herds of buffalo, lots of different zebra herds, pigs. Paul, you want to know if I've eaten a lot of wild game. Paul, I've eaten quite a lot. Not as much as, say, the Nkuhuma pride has eaten. I've had buffalo steak, which is like... I don't know if you've still got the shoes that you went to school in, but if you were to take them and to cook them over a fire for a little while and then put a bit of salt on them, that's what it would taste like. Very, very tough indeed. I've had Nyala, which is pretty good. I've had Giraffe, which is both not very tasty and very tough. What else have I had? I think Impala is quite nice. Venison out here, though, tends to be best when it's stewed. Then it is delicious. And what else? I've had and Warthog. Warthog is absolutely delicious. Springbok, that is our national animal, roughly the same size as an impala. A gazelle, the only Southern African gazelle that we get. And they're pretty delicious, too. What else? I've eaten crocodile, even, believe it or not, and that tastes like a mixture between fish and chicken. It's not delicious, I won't lie to you. It just tastes like chicken that's sort of gone a bit off. And I think that's probably about it. Hello, Lyatt. We're talking about eating things out here and possibly survival in the absence of Western consumer produce. You want to know if there are any fruits out here? Well, yes, there are. Not many, and they don't fruit for a long time, the trees. So these trees that we're going past now, the marulas, which we've talked about quite a lot, will fruit. The female trees will, and our one in camp has actually started fruiting already, which is nice. And they produce fruit only for about 3 or 4 weeks at a time, and then there's no fruit anymore. And then we get something called a sour plum, which fruits for probably even less time than that. The gwari bushes make little red berries for a short period as well, probably for how long? A little bit longer at the end of the summer. They're not very nice either. Whiteberry bush, quite nice, a bit like a sweet pea. But otherwise, not a huge amount in the way of fruit out here. And I've often said, people say, well, could you survive out here? And you can, but I don't think you could survive out here as a vegetarian or a vegan. I think you would have to have some kind of meat, so you'd have to supplement whatever you gathered in terms of roots and tubers and that sort of thing with meat. And I was chatting to Herbert about it the other day. Because he, of course, comes from his mother is a Sangoma, or traditional healer, which means she knows all of the plants out here and what they're used for. And I said to him, do you think you could survive out here if you didn't hunt? And he said, no, he didn't think that at all. He think you'd have to be able to hunt, certainly in the winter months, when there really is very little in the way of roots. And those roots that there are, the tubers and bulbs and things that we find out here, are often highly toxic. So I'm often been on drive with some guests and they've said, well, you know, could you survive out here on your own? And the answer is no, probably not, because I'm no hunter. Steph, of course, has showed you how to make his traps. I'm not sure that he's ever actually caught anything in one of his traps. There's a Duiker over there, which unfortunately has been chased slightly by our sound.
To the north of the road.
There he is. She is. Mrs. Duiker. David, would you say there's a bit of mange there? No, I don't think there's any mange there. I also think it's a little male, young male. It is a male. It's got horns. It's also got something else, which I noticed, which is why I looked again for its horns. David, you say you would just walk to a lodge if you wanted to survive out here. David, that would absolutely be the most practicable plan. And if you're in the Sabi sand like we are, well, you can then, there'll be a lodge pretty much within, I wouldn't say any more than 7 kilometres of anywhere where you're standing. That Duiker is desperately trying to hide from us and doing a fairly poor job. We can still see you. Yes, that is correct. With a little nose, looking for concentrated food. A little animal like this must try and find as concentrated a food as possible so it'll be loving this time of the year. New buds and shoots. Doesn't realize that its bottom is sticking out of its hiding place. There we are. That's one for Taylor, actually. One of the bottoms of Africa. Doesn't really understand how this great big green thing with its eyes in the front has stopped here, but seems to be not looking at it, but is not going away. And I'm sure animals do see the Land Rover like that, you know, with the two lights in the front. I'm sure to many they probably do seem like eyes. The little nose, constantly smelling. And also you can see there, as the leaves blow, just look under the left eye of the Duiker, which is basically the eye that is to the right for us. Oh, come on, lift your head now. There's very clearly, you can see the entrance to the pre-orbital gland. That's how they mark their territory. It always astounds me that you don't find a Duiker or Steenbok with no eye, because they have to push sticks into that gland to mark them, to leave their scent. There. You see that? That line underneath the eye? That's where the preorbital gland is. And it just amazes me that they don't ever kind of do their eyes an injury. A wonderful Duiker sighting, David. Possibly the world's worst hiding Duiker, and that's why we've had a good time with him. Your bottom is exposed. You will be seen. Doesn't care. Right, let's continue. We're right at the dam. There we go, Jigger. Now, we were chatting about weavers earlier. Well, we weren't. Byron was casting aspersions on my birding ability. And this is where we're hoping that there'll be a bit of a weaver colony later on. But I see that the... Now, you know why we're not going to have weavers here this year. That's very sad. I'll tell you now. Well, it's not very sad on the scale of very sad things, but it's slightly disappointing, I suppose. Let me show you. I was rather hoping the wild dogs would appear here chasing something. Well, maybe we'll be lucky. This tree looked to have died, but I see that it has got some green leaves on it. But this is where the weavers were, and this is where they set up their nests. Last time round, 2 years ago. And they like to be near water, that's the village weaver. I think there's one down there. Hang on a second, everyone. I'll just go and fetch it for you. Goodness gracious, David, I'm so stiff. We did a little exercise workout yesterday, everybody, but because we're all getting old, we pushed it a little too far. While I walk down, David, there is a shongololo. Can you see it? Oh, David. I'll come and find it for you. Can you still hear me? Oh, that is a relief. Good grief, I really can hardly walk. Here it is, David. Have you got him there? An enormous songololo or millipede. And a particularly silly songololo or millipede, everybody, because it is sitting on a knobthorn tree and it has wrapped itself onto the thorns. Why are you on the thorns? Yes? No. Can't tell me. It's a problem with stupidity. It's not very communicative. But no, I thought one of the nests had fallen out, but it's actually a piece of elephant dung. Never mind, never mind. Oh! Right, we'll carry on towards the south again and just do another little foray and see if we aren't lucky with those dogs. Otherwise, we'll head off towards the east. Here is a piece of elephant dung that I had mistaken because it was behind another piece of elephant dung. Look at this. There are two beetles in here. You see them, David? Now that'll be some manner of dung beetle. Which one, I don't know. Isn't that cool? Good. Well, we'd better put it back then. Excellent. I don't know which dung beetle that is, and like I have said to you before, of course, more than 900 species of dung beetle in the world. That is many beetles. Okay, on we go. Alrighty, well, we head down to the south again. As the clouds start to look a little bit more ominous, let's head across to Byron and find out if he is still on the property or if he's lost.
I am still around, James. You can't get rid of me that easily. Brian and I were just listening to some squirrels alarm calling. So I'm just having a good look around here. And you'd be surprised how often we have found predators because of squirrels alarm calling. But the thing is, they may alarm call at anything, including birds of prey. So eagles that are flying around, I don't seem to see anything at the moment, and it sounds like they've kept quiet. The other thing is that there's some impala, a big herd of impala right next to us. So I can still hear one squirrel alarm calling in the distance over there. But I looked around and did not see anything, so I'm not sure what it is that has that squirrel so upset. And what I'd like to do is, let me move a bit closer and perhaps you can hear the squirrel, so you know what a squirrel alarm call sounds like. I'm just going to look carefully while I drive there. We are approaching a little drainage line. It is a bit thicker down here. So let's see. Also, just having a good look for any tracks crossing the road, perhaps. Let me just stop and see if that squirrel is alarm calling again. And Tina from Ontario wants to know, are there any large reptiles around? Tina, there are. This area, we do find two lizards, which are the largest lizard species in the whole of Africa. And they are called the monitor lizards. Now, the monitor lizards... Sorry, I'm just listening to those squirrels again. The monitor lizards get very, very big. Some monitor lizards will get to about this length, if you can see that, to about that length. Move my head out the way. Very, very large. You have the rock monitor and the water monitor. Obviously, the water monitor does live closer to rivers and dams and around those areas. And the rock monitor you'll find anywhere in the bush, usually in dead tree stumps. They like to live inside there. And they'll move around. Very thick-set lizards, very powerful, very strong tail that they can use as a whip in defense against any predators. And they've got quite strong jaws, so if they do bite down on something, they've got very, very powerful jaws. So Tina, those are probably the two largest lizards that we get over here. And then also snakes. We get a lot of reptiles, a lot of snakes around here. But I still think we need a bit more rain to get more activity from those reptiles, and needs to stay warm for a bit longer, and then we'll probably start seeing more activity from those animals. Just trying to see if I can get you to hear that squirrel quickly.